All right, we are over halfway through the day. The next talk is by Matteo, and he'll talk about immutable infrastructure and immutable deployments. Please go ahead.
Hi, everybody. Before start, let me show you a little disclaimer. The event depicted in this talk are real. Any similarity to any technology, living or dead, is not a mere coincidence. The illustrated approach is based on lessons learned in almost 2 years of using the methodology in a production service. So, what are the problems? One of the first problems that this methodology proposed to solve is the Snowflake server. A Snowflake server is a server that is unique because you install it, you configure it, and then you maintain it. It's your server, and it's your responsibility to take care of it, like you will do with your pet. But the problem is that a Snowflake server is a server that you can reproduce. The Snowflake servers, one of the consequences is the configuration drift. The configuration drift is the delta between a well-known start state to an unknown state that is caused by the manual configuration of the server, the manual update of the server, and even the automatic configuration. The configuration drift is present also if we use an automatic configuration management, because the tools don't cover all the aspects of the server, and with the time is difficult to manage, to maintain, or the manifest, or the configuration scripts. And when you do some manual modification to your service, because it's time consuming, is most unlikely that you backport the modification to your configuration management. This brings us a concept that I call the path of last resistance of service management. Every developer or operator will always follow the quickly, simple, and less costly way to fix a production problem, then forgot about it. These two problems bring us another problem, that is the unknown unknown. And unknown is something that you have to know, but there is no way to know what is it, because you don't know the state of your service. Let's see an example of a service. Here we have a service version A with some input that can be our configuration of the service and some output. That is the service that we want to offer to our customer. We are going to deploy a version B, and what we obtain is not a version B, but is a version A plus a version B, because we are going to deploy the change of version B on top of the change of version A, and so on. The next time we will have a version A plus a version B plus a version C. And what is the proposed solution for this problem? One of the solutions is the immutable infrastructure. The term immutable infrastructure was coined for the first time by Chad Flower in one of the blog posts, where he described a situation like with the problem that I just told you. And he formulated a simple solution based on a fact. If you are certain that your server are created in automated way and never change, all the problem disappear. If you want to deploy a new version of your system, you simply build from scratch the new one and throw away the old one. Let's see what is the deployment with an immutable infrastructure. We have our version A of our service. we deploy the version B and we obtain the version B, because every time we deploy a new version, we rebuild the version B from scratch and discard the version A. A most formal definition of immutable infrastructure can be found in the infrastructure as code book, where it tells us that an immutable infrastructure is a paradigm, is a methodology where every change is made by replace the server. And with it requires a sophistication in server management template system. She tells us that you require a sophistication, not something sophisticated. So what we need for doing an immutable infrastructure? We need an automated provisioning configuration tool. We need an automated image generation tool, an orchestrator, and a system for keep track of all the changes. For this one, we can easily use Git. Now, what is the tools that we can use, that I choose to use for implement an immutable infrastructure party? The first one is for the automatic provisioning. I choose to implement with a simple shell script, because every developer can read or understand it. And write. The shell script is simple, but at the same time very powerful. For the image generation part, I choose to use Packer. Packer have a JSON configuration file, so you can easily keep track in Git. Add the support for many provisioners, like Ansible, Puppet, Chef, and also shell scripts. And can use multiple builders, so you can choose where to build your image. For the orchestrator part, I choose to use Terraform. Terraform has their own DSL, HL, and is a declarative language configuration, so you declare what you want instead of the steps necessary to obtain what you want, like the imperative language. I think it's more simple this way. Enable you an infrastructure as code paradigm, and have multiple provider support, like, for example, Amazon, Google Cloud, Azure, and also DigitalOcean. And as a cloud platform, I choose to use DigitalOcean, because it's not expensive, simple, and have everything we need, like API, so we can use with Terraform, compute instance, snapshot, cloud image support, flow NP, and load balancer. Okay, let's talk a little why I choose these tools. Sorry for the wall of text, but I choose to use, don't use a container, because for most company, a container is not something that they know. And it's not worth the work for learning how to operate a container. Why I choose a simple shell script instead of any configuration management? Because as I told you before, almost everyone can know a shell script. And for some occasion, learning a new DSL can be a two-high learning step. Why I choose to use an approach with infrastructure as code instead of a complex orchestrator? Because again, for most company, an orchestrator like Kubernetes can be too much for what they have to do. And most of the time, when you have a complex orchestrator, you end up with two problems. One is to orchestrate your service. The other one is to manage your orchestrator. Why a simple cloud platform instead a full feature one? because most of the time you don't use all the features offered, but only a small subset. And most important, because the management is more inclined to accept a simple and not expensive solution that have a clear pricing. But at the end, the tools is not important. What is important is the people, as we can read in the findings of the Accelerate book. Tools and technology is irrelevant if the people that have to use them hate them. Let's see what can look like an implementation of an immutable infrastructure. First of all, the application that we are going to deploy is a simple application, one Go binary. It's deployed on GitHub release, so we can easily download it. Have one attached database, and most important, is made following the 12-factor app principle. In particular, for the code base, so we have one code base for main deployment. Config, we are going to store all the configuration in the environment variables. Process, our application must be stateless as possible. Disposability, our application will be destroyed in any moment, so we have to bear with it. Let's see the resulting Git repository layout. Here we have our Packer configuration, the provisioning files, and the Terraform configuration. Here we can see a simple systemd unit file. It's a pretty standard. The important part are the environment file option that tell to systemd to load the environment variables from this file in our application. And the other is the after cloud init directive, because we are going to use cloud init for write the file. Here we have the Packer configuration. Packer will spin up an instance. In this case, we are going to use the DigitalOcean builder. So when the instance is ready, he will launch a series of provisioner. In this case, we can see that we use the file provisioner for copy the systemd unit file. Then we are going to use a shell script inline where we create the directory of our application, download it, make it executable, then reload the systemd configuration and enable the app on boot. When the provisioners are finished, the Packer will shut down the machine and take a snapshot. We can see the output of Packer with all the phases, like the creation of the instance, the provisioning, shutting down, and creation of the snapshot. At the end, Packer will output the name of the just created snapshot. For the Terraform part, we can see the configuration of the droplet that we are going to create. Most important part are the data resource DigitalOcean image, where we import the just created snapshot, and we are going to use as base image for our droplet. Another important part are the user data, where we are going to tell to Terraform and the DigitalOcean to populate the user data, the cloud user data, with the provided configuration that we are going to see. And another important property is the create before destroy, because in this way, Terraform, when we are going to destroy our droplet, will be first spin up a new droplet. When the new droplet is ready, destroy the old one for minimize the downtime. Here we can see the Cloudini template configuration. This is a simple database configuration where we are going to populate the template of Cloudini with the property exposed by the database resource created by Terraform. Okay, in the file that systemd will going to read. Here we have the DNS configuration is a simple standard DNS configuration. We create the domain for our application, the record A, but the important thing is that we also create a floating IP that we are going to point to our droplet. Then we're going to use the float IP in the record A. So when we deploy a new version, we don't have a downtime caused by the DNS propagation. And finally, we have our database configuration is pretty standard. We use Postgres with one instance. So what is the resulting workflow of an immutable infrastructure? If we want to release a new version of our application, we are going to create a new snapshot, then add it to the Terraform configuration and apply it. Terraform will destroy the old droplet and create a new one. If we want to modify the configuration of our service, we are going to modify the Cloudini template. Then, because we can't change a Cloudini user data once it's created, Terraform will be destroy the old droplet and create a new one with the update user data. In conclusion, what is the benefit of an immutable infrastructure party? One of the first benefits is the lowering of the deployment pain, because we have a very simple provisioning, because we don't have to care about the previous state, we don't care to be idempotency, but also a simple shell script can do the work. We can easily roll back in case of failure, and most of the time is a matter of doing a git revert, git restore, and we can achieve the horizontal scalability, because now all the servers are the same, all the images are the same, so we can easily put a load balancer in front of our application and scale up with the count property of Terraform. We can easily reproduce our server, our service, because we have all the snapshots, but also most important, because we have automatized all the provisioning process, we can easily use the same provisioning script for create a local environment, for example, with Vagrant. What is the impact of an immutable infrastructure party? If we are going to do an immutable infrastructure, we are going to also have an automated provisioning and an immutable and in infrastructure as code party. And for do these two things, we need of a source version control, but also the other way. So if we have a version control, we can easily adopt an automated provisioning, infrastructure as code, and then immutable infrastructure. What is the trade-off of an immutable infrastructure? One of the most important things is to separate what is mutable from what is immutable. For example, the binary of our application is mutable. Maybe also the graphical asset. What is not immutable is the database, obviously. But another thing is mutable is the HTTPS certificate, because if we are going to create the certificate every time we spin up our application and manage in our application, every time we are going to destroy our droplet, we are going to request a new certificate, and we are going to easily hit the quota limit of 5 certificates with Let's Encrypt. Don't ask because why I know. Okay. And in conclusion, further steps from here, because we don't can store anymore the logs in our machine because we are going to destroy it. We have to set up a centralized logging system, for example, like Greylog, Elkstack, or also Loki, the Grafana, because most of the time when you destroy an instance, you lost also all the metrics. So you have to implement it a centralized monitoring system, like, for example, Prometheus Grafana. And also a further step for debugging if you have a complex distributed system can be the introduction of a distributed tracing tool like Jagger. So that's all. I'm Matteo Valentini, a developer for an Italian open source company called Netesis. Thank you for listening. Question?